Hello everybody and welcome to our channel. You're viewing part 2 of our coverage creation series, where we'll be going over transmitter settings. If you're familiar with this, you can skip forward to part 3 for our overlay settings and plotting coverage arrays. The first field in this transmitter settings section is your coverage name. If you hover over this, you're going to see a suggested naming convention. This is going to make coverages easier to identify down the line. If there's a convention that makes more sense to you, then use it. But it's a good idea to keep things consistent. I'm going to go ahead and select a radio system here. If you're unfamiliar with what a radio system is, it's basically a shortcut during coverage creation, and it comes in handy if you use the same system throughout your network. From the dropdown, you're simply going to select the system you created, and you're good to go. Keep in mind though, if you make an error while creating the system, it's not going to check it for you, it's just going to pull in the data, so make sure that you have your settings accurate before you do this. Let's go ahead and talk about antenna type. TowerCoverage.com uses antenna pattern files to help with the propagation of your coverage. To get the best results possible, you'll want to select the pattern file associated with your equipment. If you can't find your equipment in the dropdown, you can source it from the manufacturer and upload it. You can also choose a generic option if you'd like, it's up to you how you want to approach it. For some customers, the generic option works fine. Antenna gain is the normal dBi of the antenna you use. To get the most out of this setting, we recommend using the largest antenna that you allow for installs. Moving on to the EUS BeamWidth Filter. Most of the time, you'll want to set this to the advertised BeamWidth of your antenna. This is to avoid shooting up the side lobes or back feed of your antenna equipment. It doesn't affect propagation, but it will affect a path analysis, so be aware of that. Antenna azimuth is the direction that the antenna is pointing. Only for directional antennas, not for omni antennas. In most cases, you'll be using a spectral antenna. The antenna tilt field is for adding or removing mechanical antenna tilt. Electrical tilt should be included in the antenna pattern. If your antenna has a physical tilt to it, you'll need to enter the correction here. As for frequency and channel width, the most common radio frequencies used by WISPs are the 2.4 GHz bands and the upper and lower 5 GHz bands. That being said, there are plenty of other radio frequencies to pick from. If you use a frequency band that's not listed, please contact us at support@towercoverage.com and we'll be happy to help you as much as possible. Exact center frequency is the exact frequency that you currently have the transmitter operating on. It's optional, but it's useful in that if you opt into it, you can see possible interference in your own network. TX power you're going to get from the manufacturer datasheet. Tower coverage stores this data in dBm, however, some radios are listed as milliwatts or watts. We include a milliwatt to dBm converter in this field. If you want an alternative option, there are converters available online for you to use. For your TX line loss, this is kind of similar to the RX line loss you would have seen in part 1. Typical values for this is going to be 0 to 0.5, so you can leave it as is, you can add a little bit of loss, that one's up to you. This concludes part 2 of our coverage creation series. For more on this topic, please continue to part 3, where we'll cover overlay settings and plotting coverage arrays. If you found this video helpful, please like and subscribe. That is all I have for now, guys, but I will see you for the next one.